I have lots of things I want to try and show you all, and some of them will work and some of them won't work because there's so many of them and it's really difficult to do it all at the same time. In fact, just bear with me for a minute. I'll just organize a few things. Oh, sorry. This is the bit I was trying to quietly do off to the side. Okay, I'll hide some over here. Right, okay. What I do is, me and my team, we make paper interactive. So this is one of the things that we made a few years ago, and it's kind of fun and people seem to like it. So if I see a drum poster, then I expect that when I touch it, it's going to play some drum sound. So, oop. I don't know if you can hear that. Yeah, it's kind of fun. So I can pass this around. If you can try and do it in time to when I speak, that would be cool. Yeah, so that's the sort of thing that we create. We print conductive inks onto stickers, and then we add some graphics, and then we add a small circuit board, and we make the thing interactive. A talk I gave a few years ago, I was asked to say, where did this idea come from, and where did it begin? And it's kind of like when I walk into a room, someone might say, oh, where have you just come from? I kind of have a flashback all the way through my journey, you know, from the hotel and where I came from. And I end up sometimes saying, from my mother's womb, which is kind of really quite a strange thing to say. But sometimes, like in life, you just don't know where the journey begins. So when I was asked to give a talk a few years ago and think about how it started, I ended up thinking about when I was a child. And I kind of was a strange child, I guess, just when I think back of some of the things that I used to do. I used to really enjoy pulling apart my brothers and sisters' toys. They didn't really appreciate it. I was quite good at pulling them apart. I just wasn't very good at putting them back together. I thought that would be maybe a challenge for them. And I also used to get like switches and wires and speakers and a microphone, and I would hide the wires under my carpet and behind the bookshelves and hide the switches, and then I'd either crawl under my bed or crawl in a cupboard or in the loft space, and then flick a switch and speak through the microphone and make my voice come out of another part of the room, and then I'd call them in just so I could try and totally confuse them. They were already confused about me anyway. But it wasn't, looking back, it's never really been an obsession with technology. It's been about trying to make a space or a place magically interactive. And it's not really the tech that I'm interested in. It's someone's experience. It's how it makes someone feel, or a journey that it can take someone on. One of the other things I remember doing was, and this is just, it's kind of a sin really, I carved the inside out of one of my dad's favorite books. I think it was Captain Hornblower, and I'm embarrassed about the thought of that now. But I carved out the inside of this book, and then from the back of a magazine, I found that you could order like radio transmitters. So I ordered this radio transmitter and built it and soldered it all up, and then hid the radio transmitter inside the book. And then, oh, someone's playing the drums over there. hid the transmitter in the book, and then went and hid the book next to my parents, and then went back to my bedroom and tuned in my radio so I could listen to what they were saying. Is not a very good idea. I'm kind of scarred from that. And I wish I could, well, I don't wish I could remember. It's been erased from my memory. But again, it was kind of like trying to make things magically connected and magically interactive. And it was never really about the thing that I was making. It's always about the experience that I could try and create. When I was at school, I was kind of just quite confused in general with understanding everything, and I managed to basically totally fail my high school. I think my A levels, which is what you do to go to university, I think I got a D in physics and an N in design and an N in maths. I don't remember what an N stands for, but I think it might be for like not even. And as I think maybe as a reward, my parents bought me a one-way ticket to Australia, and I kind of like left when I was 20, and I didn't come home for 4 years. And I just remember just arriving on the other side of the world, and I think I arrived at like 11 o'clock at night. I had a few hundred dollars, and I didn't know anyone. I didn't know where I was going to stay. And I just remember the hotel, the airport doors, like just closing behind me and just thinking, that's the rest of my life behind me. And there's this crazy unknown in front of me. And somehow I managed to keep going for like 4 years. And I ended up in the outback of Australia and in like kind of ran out of money. And I asked someone in a bar if they knew of a job anywhere. And someone told me that there was a job on a sheep farm just outside town. And if I could ride a motorbike, then I could probably have the job. And they said, can you ride a motorbike? And I was like, yeah, of course I can ride a motorbike. I've never ridden a motorbike in my life. And fell off it every single day. But I worked on that farm for 2 years. And my job on this 120,000 acre farm, there was 22,000 sheep. And there was just a farming couple and a four-year-old daughter, and my job was to be on the bike and help to round up the sheep. And I remember thinking that these sheep just didn't do what you wanted them to do. You know, you just think they're stupid sheep, and it's like, well, they're kind of wrapped in wool in 40-degree heat on the other side of the world, and we expect them to be happy and do what they do. And with hindsight, I realized we were the ones that were stupid. But what I learned is how to get the sheep to do what you want is not about doing anything to the sheep. It's about understanding the environment. And I learned that if you understand where the food or where the water is, if you understand the direction they walk in the wind, where the fences are and the noises that you make, then you can allow the sheep to move through the landscape, through the environment, and go exactly where you want. And that's something that then stuck with me. Anyway, I traveled for a few more years, and somehow I managed to blag my way into a university, and I did my first degree in electronics, and I did really well at that, even though they didn't want me to join. And then, because I did so well, I got to go to Cambridge and do a PhD in physics, and I got like an N in physics, and I didn't do an undergraduate in physics, and somehow I'm at Cambridge University doing physics. It was almost like the motorbike thing. And my PhD was to look at how to move single electrons around one by one. And because I didn't know really much of the physics, I didn't know the things you weren't supposed to do, the things you weren't supposed to try, how things were supposed to work. So I just kind of twiddled around with things, and the things I wanted to do, I remember the scientists at Hitachi told me were not possible. And somehow I managed to move these electrons around one by one and do things that no one had ever done before, just because I didn't know any better. But really, what I did know was that if you change the environment, the electrons are just like sheep. Kind of, in my mind, they're just like sheep. If you lower the temperature to put them in liquid helium, so like minus 240 degrees, and you make things really small. So I made wires of silicon that were just 40 billionths of a meter across, and you change the voltage, then you can get these electrons to do things because of the environment that they flow through. And that was kind of like a lesson I'd got from the sheep station, and it's kind of something that stuck with me a lot, really understanding a whole environment, a whole ecosystem of everything, and how you allow things to do what you want them to do. After that, one of the professors was starting a company that was going to print transistors from plastic. And so I joined this startup company, and there was just five of us when I joined. This was about maybe like 16, 17 years ago. And And I built their first few inkjet printers. So we were basically 3D printing transistors, and it was really cool. And I worked there for 4 years, and I enjoyed it for a while. And then after a while, they just had so much money and so much investment, I found that they stopped thinking. I think in total they had over $500 million invested in them. And I tried to explain that lack of resources is what makes you resourceful. So anyway, I quit, but I'd been really inspired by printing and just all of the things that printing can do. And when I would go in printing factories or converting factories, I'd see the machines that would print with flexo, offset litho, screen printing, gravure printing, and I'd see processes like lamination and foiling, demetallization, and I saw exactly the same processes that we used to use in the clean room to make these circuits. And so I started to use them, and in my garage where I started my business, I started to print transistors, and I was pretty pleased with myself. I think at the time I probably printed some of the world's best printed transistors. I also realized I'd created the world's worst transistors, and it was kind of like the transistors from Intel 1969. So I had to like look at what I was doing, and I realized that really to print these circuits, to print these transistor circuits and print little displays and to print batteries and things, which is really what I wanted to do. I wanted to print everything. My fantasy was to print the time next to the date on a newspaper. So it would last 24 hours and you'd have this clock on a newspaper page. It's totally impossible, but that's kind of like what I was driven by. But I realized that wasn't going to happen and it would take too much money and too much time. So I looked at what I could do, which was just print the conductive inks. And then I looked at the sort of chips that were everywhere, which you'd have in a greetings card or a Happy Meal, and take one of those chips and stick it onto the piece of paper. So then I could start to make these things interactive by using what was already around me and using all the lessons that I'd learned. So I made these things, and I remember we printed these conductive tracks, and everything I printed and everything I made, I was just, it was cool what it could do, but it just embarrassed me how it looked. And I thought it looked like Doc Brown from Back to the Future science experiment with, you know, it looked as if there was wires coming out. I mean, there weren't, but that's how it looked to me. And I wanted to make things just look beautiful. And where you didn't really see the technology, or the technology became so part of the design, you couldn't tell the difference. And I also remember we printed these tracks, and we had this battery on a piece of paper, and we were attaching these LEDs with a pair of tweezers. A friend of mine was doing it for me, and she got fed up with it. And she just went, oh, and sighed. And all the LEDs came on, and her breath had landed on the conductive ink tracks between some of the tracks and caused a short circuit and made the lights come on. We thought, wow, we've just invented a breath sensor, which is really cool. And then because I just felt this need to have design, and being a scientist and an engineer, being ashamed of what I do, she went off to a university and she found someone doing their degree show who'd done design. And she came along and joined us. And I asked her to design a greetings card where she was very heavy on the line art. And then I went into Photoshop and just put little cuts into the line art. And then we added that onto a greetings card. And it was an image of a cupcake. I wish I had the image to show you. It was a really, really beautiful image. And we created it so when you picked it up, where you held it, you accidentally touched these flowers in the design that were sensors, and it made the current route through the drawing and go to the LEDs on the little candles on the cupcake. So the candles lit up and flickered, and then you're like, oh, I'll blow the candles out. So then, and through this cupcake was a swirl of some tracks, and when you blew on it, it blew the candles out. But only two of the candles would go out, because that's what happens, right? So you have to blow on it again, and then when you blow on it again, a little piezo speaker in the card starts to play Happy Birthday. And it was a really beautiful object, and this was quite a few years ago when we created this. And the thing that just really struck me is that the art and the science were inseparable. because the circuit, you could see the circuit, but you couldn't see the circuit. The two things were the same thing. And the design and the technology in the same ways were inseparable. And it really inspired me with this idea of creating objects and things that there is no difference between art and science. You don't do some clever science and then turn that into some technology and then have a designer and an artist make it look beautiful further on down the line. We have to work together from the very beginning. And I just saw art and science as like two sides of a coin. You can't have one without the other. And that's what we started to try to do. And again, from when I was a kid, it was never really about the technology. It's just about allowing these things to happen. You know, I just say a load of stuff. I never know what I'm actually going to say. So just tell stories. Let me have a little look in my little book over here. Just bear with me a moment. Everything is a part of everything, so it's all good. I was going to say a little bit more about print, just while I remember. So print is the most pervasive manufacturing process. It's absolutely everywhere, in every city, even in our homes, and it's how we make things in really high volume, and it's transformed the world many times. And it's also the most pervasive communication method. I mean, print's everywhere, tables, chairs, books, badges, absolutely everywhere. And so when I think about that, it already exists. How could we make that do something more? Instead of using print to try and create the electronics or to try and create displays, and instead of trying to turn print into computers, how could we allow the print to just do something a little bit more magical? And that's kind of really what I've been trying to do. And then I think about the journey of electronics and computers. Computers used to fill a room, then they filled our desk, then they filled our lap, and then now they fill the palm of our hands. So the journey of computers is ultimately to disappear. So one day we'll wake up and all of the technology and all of the computers will just be gone. Like, hopefully, tomorrow. but it will be within all of the things. So all of the things around us will be magically interactive. And then when I think about the future, and when we try to portray the future, we think about the future as being about technical progress. So whenever we try to portray it, we make the future look futuristic in terms of technology, like Minority Report and the Jetsons. But people in the future will be kind of over futuristic. And although we long for the future, we're always nostalgic about the past. So we always try to make things look old-fashioned. So I believe the future will look more like the past than the present. And instead of being like Minority Report and the Jetsons, it'll be more like Harry Potter, Mary Poppins, and maybe the time of King Arthur, when we don't really know when it was, is maybe in like 200 years from now, you can talk to an object and it does what you want. You can wave your hand and something will do what you want. You can touch something and it will do something. And that's really what the future will be like. And all of the technology will be invisible. And that's also part of the journey that I'm on and inspires the things that we're trying to create. So when I walk down the street, I imagine that the floor is making sounds as I step on it. Or I imagine if I touch the wall, I can play music and make things happen. Or, you know, if I touch my hat, then it connects and does something somewhere. And then I tell people these things, and then some of them believed me and said, right, now make that happen. On the music thing, we ended up making an installation for Bud Light at South by Southwest last year. And I can play a little video of that, which hopefully will make sense. So we made four installations, and we made a 50-foot wall in the street that was interactive with hundreds of touch points. Right. Just bear with me a second, sorry. Technology needs to disappear, it really does. I should just be able to touch something and it magically happen. This one? No. Oh no. Okay. That's kind of stressful. Okay. You can all gather around my cell phone. Yeah, thank you.
Hold on to me, 'cause I'm a little unsteady.
Thank you. So that was really fun. It was amazing. I just doing this is not just me. There's my colleagues, and there's a team of 8 of us. And quite a few of us went over to South by Southwest to do that. And we spent 20 days building these installations. And then Bud Light were able to give us the sounds from the artists. And so we take a song and we break up all the parts of the song, and we can put it all over the walls. And so you can touch them, and then suddenly you feel like you're a music producer, which is great, because I love playing around with music, but I'm not a musician and I'm not a DJ, but I get to pretend that I am, which is really fun. So something else I did, I'm just going to plug the audio. Okay. Right, something else that I did a few years ago, this is quite a few years old, so it is a bit temperamental, so I have to keep my fingers crossed. Yeah, cool. So we made these DJ decks out of paper, and we made them for DJ Cuba, and they're paper-thin DJ decks, and they're Bluetooth, and we printed the album cover and everything, and it was he's probably the best scratch DJ in the world, so making turntables for him was kind of cool and also a little stressful. Okay. You can tell I'm not a DJ, but I have fun. And the decks actually work. You can scratch, which is kind of cool. Yeah, I'll put that over there. What happened after that was, maybe a little while later, was Pizza Hut asked us if we could turn the box into DJ decks. And we get asked, so this came out in the UK, there was only really a handful and it was like a treasure hunt, but you can actually DJ with them. And I get asked what happens if there was pizza in the actual box, and you just, people like to ask that question. And the answer is you just get extra cheesy tunes. I'll pass this round to... maybe I'll try and play another video if this works. I have no sense of time either, so we could be here all evening. Right. Okay. So they had a DJ in the UK demo this, and he's very cool, but he's too cool to show any enthusiasm. So, you know, he's talking about a world first here, but anyway, you'll see.
This is the world's first playable DJ pizza box.
Yeah. Live on mic, you know who's in charge. Who's in charge? Live on mic, you know who's in charge. Live on deck, you know who's in charge. Cause live on mic, you know who's in charge.
It's kind of fun. And I'll just show you something else we did as well in the Netherlands, which was kind of cool. We did something for McDonald's, and it's called McTrex. Huh? Sorry. Yeah.
Think about the accomplishments. I can see you watching me. Approach everyone positive, but if you can't feed your fam, you're not the man.
Creating music can really trigger creativity in young people. That's why McDonald's in the Netherlands introduced McTrex, a paper placemat turned into a full music production station. By the use of conductive ink on a piece of paper, we connected our placemat to your smartphone. Every touch point triggered a full sound bank to kickstart your creativity.
Let's go, let's go.
Let's go, let's go.
Just select the beat and you're good to go. Create your own sounds and melodies.
Ik ben gone. Ik ben gone.
Then you can tweak your track with any kind of effects. You can even record your own vocals.
To the menu, I can get you something too. Hey, my hidden beats play, what you say?
That's how you play the placemat. And this is how we challenge your talent by showing your music skills at McDonald's.
That was kind of fun. Everything ends up being music. It's not intended, but it just kind of happens. And I want to do things so much more than music. I was going to show you a little bit about how the Bud Light thing worked, just to give you a little idea and show you some of the things. I'll try my hat out as well. I'm just going to take the audio out. Right. do you know when you have a sad moment and you just feel like you just want to let everyone know? It's yeah, and then my hat does my sound effects too. Yeah. So if I feel like things are going well and I've smashed it, then that's when I just drop that. And this has some of the stems from some of the tracks on. excuse the piano, odd piano in the background.
Hold up to me.
I'll pass this round too, if anyone wants to have a play. Oh, this, you're now, you're DJing, it's cool. So all the sounds, all the loops that we put on, they're loops of the track, but they're all quantized. So whenever you hit them, they always come in time. So nothing can go wrong. But I have the ultimate control, so it's fine. Yeah. Right. I need to look for some more inspiration from my book. I'm going to take this audio. And hopefully, can you see my screen? Right, this is my book that I've been cheating and seeing where I'm up to in things. But it also has some loops on it. So we done that up a little bit. And the song that kind of, one of the songs that killed the summer was this Ed Sheeran song. So I took the parts of it and built it into this book. So there's vocals down here. And then there's vocal one shots down here. Me and my friends at the table doing shots, drinking fast and then we talk slow. Come over and start up a conversation with just me. And then I tried to create my own remix of it. Now take my hand, stop and the man on the jukebox, and then we start to dance and now. You can dance if you want. It was kind of fun. And okay, if we're in the flow for it, and I've got someone sent me some hip hop tracks that were really cool, and so I put them on the book, and that was fun. Oh, this is not hip hop. Oh, it's my fault. Well, good. I was like, why are we playing it quiet? Yeah, so I have instrumentals in these two columns, and then broken glass everywhere, people pissing on the stage, you know they just don't care. I can't take the smell, can't take the noise, got no money to move on, I guess I got no choice. Lower than I ever really thought she could. Face down. The top of your booty jiggling out your jeans. Baby, pull your pants up. I like it when I see you do it better. Now let's get it all in perspective for all y'all. Now let's get it all in perspective. Now let's get it, now let's get it, now let's get it, now let's get it. Broken glass. Lower than I ever really thought she could. Face down. The top of your booty jiggling out. Top dog, bite them all. Yeah, I'm burning it up. My favorite, Snoop Dogg and Thomas the Tank Engine. Yeah. Kind of fun. So we're trying to make all these things, and then so in my team there's some creatives, artists, and then there's some engineers. And I'm an engineer, so I can say this, but they really annoy me because everything I want to do, when I ask them, they do the thing where they suck in through their teeth and they kind of go. We can't do that. So they stand between me and the thing that I want to do. So I kind of like move them out of the way of being involved in all of the projects whenever possible. And I've had them make me a toolkit instead. So that I want to create a toolkit that's easier to use than social media so that anyone can make any of these experiences. So it's not about being a maker, it's about being a creator and using simple tools. So we can democratize design of products. So they're not made by one group of people in one place, manufactured by another group of people in another place, and everyone has to have the same product. So this is the app that I'm running, and I'll just try and show you how this could go horribly wrong. I'll try and show you how we make an app. So I click the little plus sign, make an app, connect a device, which is my red book, click design. I touch a button on the book, and then click image and plus. I've got lots of NASA stuff. I love NASA stuff. And then I click audio and plus. And let's see, what should we go for? Be confident. It's either Houston, we've got a problem, or the eagle has landed. And then you click play, and and that's how quick we can make an app. So you can add images, animated GIFs, you can add videos or sounds or sound loops. And so you can take this app, which is on the App Store, and a piece of our print and put it together, and you can make something instantly. And that's really, really what we're trying to do, is so that anyone can make anything. And earlier on this year, we had some interns join us and asked them to make some things. And it's just come to mind of something that one of them made. And it was really beautiful. It was really simple, and it made me cry. So I thought I'd share it with you. What was so cool for me is I didn't even really know her. She was working with one of my colleagues, and she took our toolkit and she made something that she wanted to make that was nothing to do with me. And people ask me, if you could make anything, what would it be? And I never know what to say, because then I've realized the answer is I want to make a toolkit that allows anyone to make anything that they want to make. And while it's easy to make it with a toolkit, it's designed already for things that can go straight into production. So this, someone could design something and then we could make them, have a million of them printed, you know, wherever. And we have like partners in different places who can make these things. So that's kind of magical. I'll just remember another project we did, which was, you might have heard of IKEA. They opened a store in Memphis, and they asked us to make an invite that would be sent out. So the store opened in last December. And we wanted to create something that connected Memphis with IKEA. So we made this box, and it's an IKEA design. And then we recorded the sounds of the home. So we sampled the sounds of the home. I'm not sure how well this is going to work for hearing it, but... I don't know if you can hear, can you hear that? Or, yeah, this is very awkward. I think I look very silly. That's coat hangers. I was gonna use a handheld mic for this, but it didn't happen. And this is our kitchen drum kit. And then drops of water. And then we added some guitar. So we had blues and the sounds of the home. Cool. And this is the pop-up of Beale Street. So we're trying to really think about how everything comes together and how we just create a magical experience for someone. And like what I said earlier, we're not trying to print computers. How do we turn a piece of paper into a computer or anything? And it really just somehow draws from everything I've done in my life and everywhere I've been, just how to make just everyday objects magically interactive for people to have some kind of experience. I can pass this round to have a little play. I'm very trusting. yeah, I think I've shown you most things. I'll pass a bit of the paper around that we do the conductive ink on. Yeah, I think that's kind of like most of the things I was going to show you. And it's just, as I kind of like think about where we want this to go, at the moment our platform is you touch any of these things and they either make sound or they connect through a smartphone and go off to the internet. And what we're really excited about doing is about connecting the objects directly off to the internet to do something. And so that anyone can configure anything to do anything. So, you know, you just touch an object either in the home or, you know, or at work or in a school or a shopping center or something. And it's not really about printing light switches and printing the sort of functional things that we imagine. It's about trying to do magical things with these everyday objects. And it's really about trying to create this sort of future that looks more like the past than the present, and trying to create this magical computer where everything, all of the technology has just disappeared. And recently, just a little side story, and then I will be quiet. But I try to sleep outside it once a week and travel, trek through the mountains, and, you know, walk for 5 hours and climb a mountain and spend an hour gathering wood and making a cup of tea. And I just think, I've just spent 8 hours to just make a cup of tea when I could have just flicked the kettle on. It's like, why did I do that? And I've just realized, like, how important, like, just journey and process is with everything that we do. And our lives have become so automated, and everything's just to touch an app or the flick of a button. It's so easy that we have kind of become surplus to requirements in our own life, and we're not even needed. So it's made me become really interested in the idea of developing technology that makes people's lives more difficult and just allows us to have some kind of experience or journey with objects, things you have to pick up or move or turn or twist somewhere. You have to get up from your seat rather than just pressing these buttons. So I think that's my next goal. I want to make things that make people's lives more difficult. And I also and at least we have a purpose. And I just want to create this magical future where it just looks old-fashioned and everything's interactive. I will stop there. Thank you very much.
My. I haven't got the slightest what to ask you. I'm blown away.
Thank you. Now,
you're like a super advanced maker rock star, isn't she? Yeah.
So, okay, this might be controversial, but I'm kind of decided to take a stance of being anti-maker.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, anti-maker. Why?
Yeah, because sort of maker stuff came around, and then sort of, like, you know, designers and artists realized they could suddenly make things, and they sold us some wires and make a red light turn green. Great. 3D print the name, or write an app that says hello world, and then think, wow, that's amazing. I've made that happen. That's really, really cool. And then it's not really cool.
No.
It just impresses ourselves. And people kind of, like, stop at that. And it's not about being a maker, it's about being a creator.
Yes.
It's about trying to create beautiful experiences for people and just not being happy with doing something where you're impressed with your technical achievement. And inside, every maker is a creator. And having to acquire these skills becomes a barrier for most people to learn code, learn to solder, and all of that. I don't want that. I want tools that are really easy and that anyone can create these beautiful experiences.
That's a paradox. So, you said make technology that makes our lives more difficult.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're all about paradoxes.
Yeah.
So what about Raspberry Pi? Is that cool or not cool?
Of course it's cool, and it's about getting people coding and getting people creating things with technology. Mm-hmm. But we have to go beyond that. And if the journey is to acquire the technical skill and you feel that then you've achieved something, it's not. You have to go, that's just getting you to the mountain. Mm-hmm. That's just getting you off the couch, in the car, along the motorway, to the mountain, get your gear out, right.
And then go
now
back home.
You got it. Yeah, now you got to begin on a journey. Like, what do you do with that Raspberry Pi? Mm-hmm. And don't stop with being content with a technical achievement, because no one cares, really.
Is it a muscle, being creative? Do you have to kind of, like, are you born with it, or are you kind of, like, can you train yourself to be creative in the way you are? I guess it takes some brain capacity that not many of us have, maybe. No, I'm not talking about you, I'm talking about myself. So, what do you think? Do you have any, I mean, you don't have to answer, but
that's okay,
I was just
answer.
Curious.
No. it's not really about what you do. Being creative, being adventurous, kind of similar things, it's a state of mind. So it's not about what you do. It's like adventure is not a place or a thing. It's a state of mind. You know, you can be creative like anywhere with no skills at all. But when you think you have to be in a certain place, be with certain people and have certain skills before you can be creative, you've already got a state of mind that means you're not going to be creative. Because being creative is just about expressing yourself mm-hmm. and using what you already know and what's already around you. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, a lot of what I learned on the farm. Because yeah. on that farm I was on, it was 50 kilometers to the nearest town. The town was in the middle of nowhere. And we had to make do with what we had, and if you didn't, you died. So that was a good place to learn to be creative.
You did survive, obviously. So I was thinking while you were talking, I mean, we've heard a lot of amazing sounds, and you say that the paper is conductive mm-hmm. in the same way as a smartphone, or what kind
In a way. So, and what we do is really simple. It is incredibly simple. And it's very difficult to make things really simple, right? And it's very difficult to make them very manufacturable. That's really been my journey. It's not been what we've created. It's been about how to make it so we could print a million of them somewhere. So everything we do uses processes that already exist. Mm-hmm. So all we do is screen print carbon ink onto a piece of paper or piece of plastic or a sticker. And then we have a circuit board that has the same chip you might find in a greetings card or a fast food meal toy. And then we just press that circuit board onto the sticker. And then when you touch the conductive ink, the circuit board knows where you've touched.
Oh, it's the ink.
It's just the ink, yeah.
It's just the ink.
It's just kind of like magic. You know, once you know how we do it, you're kind of like, is that it? it is just like pretty simple. So everyone will just walk out and be really disappointed when they realize how it's done. When you have a look at how it's done, it's really simple.
Yeah, I think you told us how you got the idea. Did you or did you not? I mean, how did you come up with the idea?
And that, in a way, that's why I said what I said in the beginning. It's never a point.
No.
It's just my whole life. It's yeah. just my whole journey.
Yeah.
And that's why I go back to talking about when I was a child and, you know, me at school and working on the farms and things. I don't know where it started.
Yeah.
It's just, I think the things that drive me positively and negatively. The positive one is curiosity. I'm just absolutely driven by being curious. Mm-hmm. What's inside? What's on the other side? How does something work? How can I make someone laugh? And the thing that drives me sort of like negatively is the fear of regret.
Mm-hmm.
So my greatest fear in life is regret. And you know that I mean that's one of the things that I've learned. And I mean, I go into the wilderness a lot, and last weekend, the message that the mountains gave me was be aware, be prepared, be mindful, but never let being afraid be the reason that you don't do something. Mm-hmm. And so I've realized that my biggest fear is regret.
Yeah.
So even though I'm scared of a grizzly bear, regretting not going out and sleeping where the grizzly bears sleep.
That's an inside joke, by the way. I know what she's talking about. You don't. So you went hiking in Sweden just before you came here.
Yeah, I woke up on a beach yesterday, which was kind of cool.
Yeah.
Like about an hour and a half north of here in my hammock on a beach. I pretended I was in like, you know, like Barbados or somewhere, but it was 5 degrees and but it was really beautiful and really magical.
Yeah.
And that's what I try to do, because that's where a lot of my inspiration comes from.
Yeah.
Is being in the forest, being in nature,
yeah.
being on a mountain.
Does that mean you're taking a time out, or are you kind of always happy to go to work? Kind of like, are you even going to work?
There's no difference.
Yeah.
Everything's connected. Work and play, it's all just one thing.
Yeah. It's almost spiritual, I think. And
yeah.
honestly, I mean
yeah.
that. Yeah.
No, thank you. I think so. That's how I see it. I don't see it as technology. I see what I do as a philosophy
yeah.
and a state of mind.
Yeah.
And having that philosophy and state of mind allows these things to manifest. And then I feel that I'm channeling something from somewhere else, and it's not really me.
Mm-hmm.
Just the same as when I go in the wilderness and nature speaks to me. It tells me these things and I just channel them.
Yeah. So. Oh, you're really open. I mean, we should all try that. Go out in the nature and channel things.
Yeah, I think every day or every week, you need to be afraid and you need to have an adventure, like at least every week.
Every
and
week.
Sleep outside one night a week as well is pretty cool. I'm pretty cold.
Cool and pretty cold. So I have another and probably a stupid question. Harry Potter, you uh-huh. just mentioned him briefly. And he has these, in the films, there are these papers with moving images. Mm-hmm. Is that possible, you think, to do? I mean, you're doing a lot of things with sound, but will there be a future when we have paper that are kind of like films or movies alongside with the articles? Or what do you think?
It's possible, and people have done that already. And that's what we were working on when I worked at the other company, how to print transistor arrays so we could make paper that had a moving image on it. Mm-hmm. And they did that. It's just that you're trying to recreate a computer in a piece of paper, and you think of it as a computer. And so you become obsessed with the technology and achieving that thing. I want to do a video in a piece of paper. It's like, well, you kind of got a smartphone. It's pretty good for videos. Yeah. So we don't think of things like that. We think about the experience that we can create for someone that's manufacturable first, and doing it with the dumbest technology and the most simple way that we can. So that's what we try to think of. A few years ago, we were working with inks that change color. So there are inks that can change color when you pass a voltage over them. And they're really slow to change. You can't do video. And they're quite low resolution. So what we did is we made this poster of like a park with a park bench and a telephone box and trees and flowers and things. And then we connected the poster into the energy monitoring of the house. So instead of seeing the energy levels like on dials on a screen, because that doesn't really inspire me very much, I wanted to think of like, you know how if you don't water a plant, like if you don't water those plants, are they real? I don't know if they're real. If you don't water the plants in a house and they kind of like droop, so you look after them. So this poster, when your energy usage is trending worse, the phone box gets smashed, the park bench gets graffiti, and the flowers fade away. And if your energy usage gets better, then the bunny rabbits come out and the flowers come out and all is good. So I wanted to create a piece of art that by looking after your environment, it looks after your building, or how well you look after your environment is reflected in the things that are around you, because there's a disconnect. Yeah. So it might not be a video screen in a newspaper, but maybe it's just something more magical and more meaningful.
Yeah.
And sometimes we try and achieve the wrong thing because we're not very creative.
Like a Tamagotchi on steroids, or these little rings that I used to have when I was little that changed colors.
Yeah.
Okay. Should we let the audience ask you a few questions? We have a Mentimeter here, and this has been like for the duration of the conference, like we have to read them because I can't see them from there.
Okay. I'll try and answer a few. I'll just start at the top. So there's a question, how do you find your sheep today? Do you still need that input from the outside in order to find impossible new solutions to your work? I think partly answering that in nature. It's up there too. All right. Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Everything we need is all around us if we just open our eyes. Yeah. So I think that my answer for that is it comes from nature and just I'm being around just, you know, everyday people and not just being stuck in my little bubble. And actually my team are based in Cambridge and I ran away and left them behind and I live in New York. And I'm also now at New York University in the music education department. So I speak to children and work with teachers and just try and get inspired by all of these things. And I mentioned, the democratization, and that's something that's really important to me, to democratize design and democratize manufacture. And so, like I mentioned, we made these tools so that anyone can make these things. So anyone can go to our website. One of our websites is called printedtouch.com. Oh, I've just forgotten something, remember something. And you can buy the stickers and the circuit boards, and you can download the app, and also the Bluetooth one is available as well. And it's just a reminder, can I just show something quickly? just bear with me, I'm going to unplug the audio. I hope this works. It's really important to me. We made this notebook, And notebooks are called notebooks because they're supposed to play notes. at the bottom of the notebook, we're going to put one music staff along there for footnotes, which is kind of cool. and it has a folding-out piano that's now just broken. Oh, yeah. Yeah. But I can't play piano. so, yeah. So you can play piano on this. Right, I'm going to stop that. So the idea is, in this notebook, you can be writing away and making your, or taking your notes while you make some notes on here. And so you can be working on a song, or and you just think, oh, what was I thinking? And you can look back and see what you're thinking, and then you can go, oh, what was I hearing? And then it connects to an app, so you can hear what you've created, and you can fold it over and use this as a MIDI keyboard, and it's Bluetooth and connects to an app that visualizes the sound. And this shameless plug, but we're hoping to put this on Kickstarter in about 2 weeks. So trying to answer that question is, we want to make things available so people can buy them.
Right.
So, hopefully this will be for sale on Kickstarter in a couple of weeks.
That was my next question.
Yeah.
I mean, you have a company, a creative tech company, as we spoke this afternoon, and you're commercial. What's your, what projects or customers are you working at right now?
So,
if you can disclose them.
Yeah, well, it's with a few different ad agencies. So a lot of what we discovered a few years ago is that we could create these experiences with ad agencies for brands. And it was a really great way of allowing what we developed to manifest in these things that became videos and went viral. So we're doing a few more of those at the moment. I think we did another one for Pizza Hut recently. Mm. And some of them have won some ad agency awards at Cannes and places, which is kind of cool. But I think where I want to go next is, I mean, we're exploring with a few companies who have their own products to license the technology to them, but everyone's frustratingly slow. And so we want to start to make some of our own products. And so this is one of the first things we're going to make. And
like
we can
consumer
make
a product.
Yeah. So, so this will be, if this is successful, we can make a range of books with keyboards, QWERTY keyboards, numerical keyboards, drum pads, and an XY trackpad so you can draw with your finger on a panel so that anyone can have this kind of experience.
I would love to have the birthday card as well.
Yeah, I mean, that was a long while ago, and it never happened just because
the
most boring reasons.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Biophilia project. Do you know what the biophilia project is? No?
What does that mean?
I don't know. Seems interconnected to your work. Who asked that question?
Who asked that question?
Yeah. Do you want to start?
I'm not sure. It's a project which is started with Björn, the artist. She made a record and then she released an app called the work which would
Yeah, no, I haven't, but I will. I should look it up. And
you
then,
like Björk?
Yeah. Oh, right. Okay, I see. I didn't quite hear. Right, now I do realize what you said. Okay.
Björk, you know the singer from Iceland.
Okay, I need to do some investigation.
Yeah,
I feel as though if I answer the question, I'll answer the wrong question. Yeah. Just, I'm not going
to
do that.
She'll call Björk and she'll be able to answer your question the next time. Next year.
Cool. The microphone and camera into paper. So what we do with the Bluetooth stuff is we use what's available on the cell phone. So we try to use the paper as just a touch input because we all have our smartphones and it's got a great screen, great camera, great microphone, and we can use that. On our circuit boards of the things that make the sound, there is the circuitry for a microphone on there, and we could add that. So you can have panels that you hold down a button, speak to the panel, it records your voice, and then you can touch it and hear your voice come back. Mm-hmm. And that could be great for education, for special needs. It could be great like in a hospital or something. So, you know, I ended up in an unfortunate situation 3.5 years ago where I couldn't speak. It's a crazy story.
Yeah.
I couldn't speak, move, write, or do anything, and I couldn't let anyone know what I wanted. So if I had a panel that I could touch and it said things, then that would be really useful.
I'm sorry to hear that.
That's all right.
All right.
I'm alive. I was gored by a stag.
Yeah,
I was gored by a stag. What? A stag, but it's ant. It's a whole other story.
Oh, okay. You don't want to tell it. No. Was that in New York? Don't go to New York.
It was walking home from the pub in Scotland. Ooh. Yeah. I got gored by a stag.
Don't go to Scotland.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, move on from that. We haven't done anything with fragrances, but that would be fun.
Who asked that question?
Yeah, that idea stinks. the printing we predominantly use is screen printing, so the same process you use to print t-shirts, and we screen print a carbon ink. But we also do things with flexo printing, which is the process that will be printing this label on here. In a flexo print process, we print silver and we print carbon on multiple stations, and we would use that if we wanted to do very high volume. And using that process, we can print 5x7 or A5, we can print A5 multi-touch trackpads at 100 meters a minute, and we print the sensor like that and then add the circuit board on. Wow. So we've used flexo, we use screen predominantly, and we've also tried with offset litho. But it's not about a special printer.
Yeah.
It's about using printers, as in the people, the factories, the processes, the materials that already exist and have existed for years. It's how do we weave it into existing manufacturing chains, supply chains, objects and things. It's just how you make what you need from your environment.
Mm-hmm. I have a question.
I don't think anything in Sweden, but I would love to, if anyone has any ideas.
You're talking about capacitive touch,
uh-huh.
And of course we all know that there are rare metals making the capacitivity, is that how you say it, work. Is it the same thing that's in a smartphone? No. I can't remember what it is. It's not lithium, that's what I have for breakfast in the morning, but it's something else.
Yeah, it's probably in indium.
Indium?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So to make a transparent sensor for a smartphone, it often uses a material called indium tin oxide, mm-hmm. which is a transparent conducting metal oxide. So it's transparent and it conducts. and I think that material's fairly rare, or yeah. You know, it's disappearing. And that's made by a process generally of etching that material onto glass.
Mm-hmm.
But what we do is for the capacitive touch is because we're doing these larger surfaces and we don't need the same resolution, mm-hmm. we screen print carbon ink.
Yeah.
I've said that like 5 times, but it's just... Yes. I didn't mean like that. I'm like, I hear myself repeating myself. It's just an ink that's been around for years.
Yeah.
So in most of these things, all of these things I've shown, it's just carbon.
It's like e-ink, is it? Is it the same thing? Like
no, because that's high-tech materials. That's a material, the little spheres that are coloured dark on one side,
yeah.
or dark on one side, light on another, and you pass a voltage over them and then they flip one way or another. This is just carbon ink. I mean, you could take a paintbrush and paint it on.
It's so simple that I can't get into my head. You know? Is there anything, do we have any other question, like live from the audience, before we start dancing?
Yeah.
I'm just joking. No, I'm not joking, actually. We should put on some music and
yeah.
have a shake. Is there any questions live from the audience? Don't be shy. I mean, she's here once a year, or at least here on this stage today. God knows when she'll be back. Come on.
What, sorry? Kind of project? It's always about the people that I meet. It's not generally, it's about like meeting interesting people, talking about some ideas, and then thinking about things that are relevant to them and to their environment. So it's never really driven by a particular thing that I have. I like to try and create things that mean something to somebody else. So I know it's not a particularly good answer, but it shouldn't be what I want to do. It should be what we want to do.
Yeah.
So that's kind of like how I work.
Not denying the world what could happen and
yeah.
your creativity.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
I want to just be inspired by whoever I meet and wherever I go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought we had one more question. Someone was waving their hand. Yeah?
I Yeah, it's very difficult when we get stuck with labels. And I think labels cause a lot of issues for us. So I don't know if I'm an engineer. I don't know if I'm a scientist. I don't think I'm an artist, and I don't think I'm a designer, but then people say that I am like an artist or a designer or a musician, and I'm like, really? you know, suddenly I've done this little remix or something, and I don't think I'm any of those things. I don't think any of us should really necessarily put ourselves in a box of being a specific thing. I mean, there's like a box maybe is an area that you predominantly are, but I seem to float about through all of those things. So the nearest thing I can say is I call myself a creative scientist, just because that's kind of like the nearest way I can explain it or put a label on it.
Yeah, you talked about getting outside your comfort zone.
Yeah.
And labeling yourself,
yeah,
I guess, is being inside it.
It is, because we want to have outside the box thoughts, but there isn't a box. There isn't really a box. Like, our box is defined by our thoughts and who we say we are. So every new thought or description we have of who we are redefines our box. So every thought is always inside the box, because that's who we are. So we just, if we stop with the labels, and we work with people outside, and everything we create is through collaboration, that's the only way we can get out of our box.